Good morning, KCPC. Good morning. Let's rise from our seats and turn to one another and say, Happy Sunday. Good morning. Happy Sunday. Well, welcome to KCPC, English Congregation, where our vision is one gospel for all walks of life. Let's bring our attention to the screen as we receive our call to worship that comes from Psalm chapter 112. I'll read where it says presider, and we as the whole congregation will read out loud where it says all. Praise the Lord. Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. His offspring will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. Light dawns in the darkness for the upright. He is gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with a man who deals generously and lends, who conducts his affairs with justice. For the righteous will never be moved. He will be remembered forever. He is not afraid of bad news. His heart is firm, trusting in the Lord. His heart is steady. He will not be afraid until he looks in triumph on his adversaries. He has distributed freely. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. His horn is exalted in honor. This is his word for us. Amen. I will now invite Deacon Christopher Lee to come up and to representatively pray on behalf of our worship service. Let's bow our heads in prayer.
Dear Lord, we're grateful to be gathered together today to worship your holy name. We offer our worship and adoration to you, for you are worthy to be praised. We lift our voices together to offer you all that you deserve. We ask that you bless this time of worship so that we may be uplifted and inspired by your presence. Fill us with your love and grace, and help us to honor you in all that we do. May our worship be pleasing to you, and may we be transformed by the power of your Spirit. Lord, we confess that we have put our agenda ahead of yours. We have trusted on our own timing and instead of yours. We have trusted our own cleverness rather than lean into your holiness. And we have not lived the way that showed the glory of God in our lives. Purify our hearts, Lord. We ask for your forgiveness. Set our feet on the right path that leads to the kingdom of heaven and have intimacy with you. We thank you for the successful EC Vision retreat that we had over the weekend. Let us always be humble, be gentle, be patient with each other, be understanding, work hard for peace, celebrate each other's unique gifts, follow those with leadership gifts, and speak with the truth and love so we may have unity in our church. God of hope, may you fill our Pastor David Moon with all joy and peace as he trusts in you, so that he may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit when he delivers a message to them. Let us praise and worship you and make your name high. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us sing unto the Lord together, shall we?
Thank you.
strong in his love. Lord Jesus, we thank you. Thank you for being our rock, being our righteousness, that we can place our hope, our lives upon you. Despite the storms and the various things that we may face, we look to you. We set our hearts and our eyes upon you until the day when you come face to face. We will see you dressed in your righteousness alone, and we'll stand before the throne saying, thank you, Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb. We give you all the praise and glory. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Let's give all the glory to Jesus Christ once again. Amen. Please have a seat. Have a seat. Church, we have declared and have sung just how glorious and how awesome, how great our God is through our Lord Jesus Christ. And as we do so, we realize how great our sins are. And so this time of confession will be a time where we get to confess before God how much of a great sinners that we are before him, and that we will confess very specifically, but also corporately together. And so we will allow the catechism to guide us in our confession today. I'll read the question, and we will read the answers together out loud. What is justification? Justification is the act of God's free grace by which he pardons all our sins and accepts us as righteous in his sight. He does so only because he counts the righteousness of Christ as ours. Justification is received by faith alone. Amen. And with that in mind, let's pray this corporate confession to the Lord together. Gracious God, you have justified us by exchanging our sins for Christ's perfection through his sacrifice. Yet we still try to justify ourselves through our own works. Forgive us for relying on our own good behavior, morals, and outward appearance. We try to cover our shame and guilt with these fig leaves when you have already covered us with Christ's robe of righteousness. Lord, we contribute nothing to our salvation except our sins that need forgiveness. By your grace alone, we are declared righteous as Jesus defends us before the just judge in heaven. We receive this rich benefit through faith alone in Christ. Teach us to trust in his righteousness and not our own. Help us to lean on him more in every moment of our lives. In his name we pray, amen, amen. With that in mind, church, I will invite you to bow your heads before our God. Let's turn to him personally, confess before him the ways that we have been trying to justify ourselves with our works, with the ways that we display ourselves in front of people. Let's go before our God, who looks at our filthy rags before him and says, that's not good enough. I've given you something far better, the robe of my son's righteousness, and I will cover you with it. So church, let's draw near to him. Let's draw near to him in confession. Brothers and sisters in Christ, you are forgiven, restored, set free. Do you believe that? Let us hear the assurance that God grants us, that gives to us, to help us to remember who we are in Christ And we will hear that from Galatians chapter 2. Yet we know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law, because by works of the law, no one will be justified. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Amen. Amen. Church, allow his words of encouragement, of his gospel assurance and forgiveness to you. Let as that truth marinates in your heart, let's respond to God with a prayer of thanksgiving, of our declaration of our trust, and for his glory to be above all else. And we will do that through the Lord Jesus, who taught us his prayer, the Lord's Prayer. And we will pray that together in one voice. Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Let us rise again from our seats. Let's continue to sing unto the Lord as we respond to his amazing grace that he lives in us, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Let's sing.
There is no more for heaven now.
Let's give all the glory to Jesus. Christ who lives in us, who is there for us. Let's give all the glory to Him. Amen. Lord, we thank You for being in us and with us. We thank You that even during this life, we no longer have to continue relying on our own strength, but to continue to rely upon the grace of God through the form of Jesus Christ, who is now in us. Truly, we are crucified with Christ. It is no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. And we give You all the glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Please have a seat, have a seat. Church, we will continue to worship our God as we give our offering to the Lord. You may give online through the description on the YouTube live stream, but also you may give through ec.kcpc.org and click on giving on the menu so that you may give online. But also, let's take some time with our prayer. Let's turn to the Lord. Let's turn to the Lord in prayer and offer ourselves, offer our hearts unto God. Lord, how can I serve You? How can I offer my life to You for all that You have done for me? Can we take some time to pray for that as we give our offering to the Lord? Let's pray. God, it is by Your grace that we have all that we have. We have been reminded of the most astounding truth that we now get to live through Christ in us. What a wonderful truth that we are united to Him, crucified with Him, and now the life we live through and in Him. So Lord, we offer our lives to You, not just with the finances, but with our obedience, with our pursuit of holiness, and with our longing to see Your name being glorified to the ends of the earth. So Lord, we give You our everything, and we give You all the glory until the race is complete. And when we see Christ face to face, it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, good morning once again to all of you. Good morning. We will actually take some time now to greet one another in love. Let us welcome one another in Christ, just as how Christ has welcomed us. And again, the reason why we are doing this is to create a warm, welcoming culture here at KCPC English Congregation. So please find someone, if possible, that you haven't met or are unfamiliar with, and please introduce yourself, what your name is, what life stage you're at. Also, today's prompt will be, what's the best meal that you've ever had, okay? Best meal you've ever had. So name, what your life stage is, best meal you've ever had, and let's come back in 3 minutes and we'll have our announcements. Let's give ourselves one more minute and come back. Let's come back together. Well, welcome to KCPC EC once again. It's good to see all of you having fellowship and getting to know one another. We're gonna go into time of announcements now. First announcements will be given by, I believe, the Women's Ministry. So I'm gonna invite them and let's give them a round of applause as they come up.
Can I have the slide up if you guys have it? Oh, there we go. Okay, so my name is Sarah, and I just wanted to share with everyone that we will be having a large group for women's ministry, and it's going to be on faith and health, a woman's journey, and what does woman's health have to do with your faith. So that's going to be on Sunday, April 7th, from 3 to 5 p.m. at Orr Chapel. That's upstairs. And so, yeah, please RSVP by March 31st. And we have Ms. Hedgen here as well.
Yeah, so this is a very special one. So as I always do, I encourage all of you guys, all the women in EC, to come out and join. The guest speakers actually will be our own EC women who are in various healthcare professions. So, you know, panelists, you know, whatever you want to call them, they're going to touch upon not only their areas of expertise, but also how that relates, our overall health relates to our faith, which is so important. So again, I just want to see so many of you guys there. Hope to see many of you. It's on a Sunday afternoon in a few weeks or so. So again, come out and join us, and we'll have a wonderful time of fellowship. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Just one more quick announcement. The Bridge to Life Evangelism Training is going to be offered from April 7th through all the way to the 28th on Sunday for 4 weeks for the English congregation. And the training hours will be 3:30 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. at room 1107. So if there's any of you who have a heart and a desire to share your faith in Jesus Christ with the people around you, we highly encourage you to sign up for this. And online registration is going on now until the 7th of April on Sunday. So you can sign up through the EC website under resources and training. And that concludes our announcements. Let us rise again from our seats. And we'll read our scripture reading today, which comes from Romans chapter 3, verses 21 through 26. This is his word for us. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe, for there is no distinction. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Good morning, KCPC. Repeat after me. My best meal. Was it favorite meal or best meal? My best meal is yet to come. And the wedding feast of the Lamb. Amen. It's yet to come. Let's summarize the past, every sermon since January until now in the book of Romans, especially last week's sermon. Let me ask you some questions. What is our greatest problem? It is universal sin, total depravity. If that is the case, what is our greatest need? It is righteousness. And if righteousness is our greatest need, what is our greatest hope? Solus Christus, Christ alone. Amen? Amen? And if Christ alone is our hope, then what is our mission? To make Christ known. This has to be clear as a laser in the life of a Christian. It will shave off so many unnecessary rabbit holes of hobbies and habits and wasted thought and energy, wasted concern. May that thought process galvanize you towards pursuing a Christ-like life. With that said, today's sermon is all about how to get the solution, Christ alone. It is a heavy, heavy, beautiful, glorious, substantive sermon that we have to talk about today. And I don't know if my heart is ready for it. The best way to prepare is by prayer. Let's pray. Father, I could groan and moan and yearn and thirst all 40 minutes that I'm up here, and it would not be enough to show the need and the power of this passage that we have just read. We need you, Christ Jesus, so much beyond our imagination and so much beyond our hopes and our dreams. Holy Spirit, the only way that this heart transfer can occur between the broken servant that is me preaching this message to the people listening, where they would have the same desires and we would have the same need for Christ Jesus, is only through the miracle of the Holy Spirit working still today, regenerating hearts and calling the lost home and opening their ears to hear what they would never listen to on their own volitional terms. So Holy Spirit, we ask for once again a daily miracle that you would open eyes and hearts that are uninterested in today's passage and captivate our imagination to help us hear your word truly. Only you can do this, Father. We rely upon you this day. Fill my mouth with your words. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The summary of our problem so far in Romans 1 and 2. Regardless of whether we have the law of God or not, the only difference, because of our fallen sin condition, between all humanity, if there's one distinction, is that we have informed sinners or misinformed sinners. We have a guilty conscience suppressing the knowledge of God despite our knowledge of Him for those that are without the law. And for those who claim to have the law, saying, I have moral standards, what they say is, I hypocritically claim to fulfill those standards, and we also fool ourselves because no one is perfect 24/7. If God showed a panorama of my thoughts and the images in my head and the desires of my heart on a screen for you to see 24/7, I would shrink and die because of the shame. No one is perfect before God, and there is no distinction. You have moral sinners and you have ignorant sinners, but there is no distinction. Because what is the actual purpose of the law? It is to reflect God's perfect standards, show how we fall under it, and thus make us excuseless before God. verse 20, the verse that we concluded with last week before we went to the message of hope today. Verse 20 says, "For by works of the law, your human efforts, humanism, your contributions, your charity, whatever good works that you do, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin." Imagine if you were a blank tabula rasa, what we call an empty slate. What if you were a blank slate? How offensive would it be if you're just living a wonderful life in paradise, eating fruit from trees and naked because there's no shame? And let's say one day that there's a law given to you and it says, "Thou shalt not kill." How offensive that is, because it's telling us, "You shall not kill because you have the propensity to kill within you." And then comes knowledge of the fact, "Oh, I can be a killer." The standard is revealed. And so some people might say this, "Pastor, does that mean that, are you saying that we are guilty because since the law says don't lie, it now creates a category of sin that would have been okay if only I didn't know? Would it have been okay to perish in my ignorance without the law of God?" No, because here's the thing. Knowledge of the law doesn't create sin. Lying is a sin because it is contrary to what? God's truthful nature. Do you get that? Murder is a sin because it is contrary to God's life-giving nature. Morality is not a grocery list of random rules and regulations that we put together. It is an infinite set of attributes that come from the virtue or overflow from God's character and his nature. That's why there is a law that reflects his character. What is our problem then? Nobody is righteous because our personhood contradicts with God's divine personhood. Our nature contradicts with God's divine nature. And the law merely shows and extrapolates how that is the case. The result then, we all deserve the wrath of God. Only in a theocentric universe where God is the center and we are not, can we say that we deserve wrath. There are humanists abounding everywhere saying, if God can judge us, he is not God. But the biblical worldview is that God is the center of the universe. He must judge sin and evil. Otherwise, he is corrupt as a judge. We deserve the wrath of God. Can you say amen to that? Amen. If I go to hell, not to cause any doubt in you for your own salvation, but if I go to hell, it will be nature crying out, "To God be the glory," because a sinner has rightly received wrath. And if I go to hell, if I go to heaven, it will be all creation crying out, "To God be the glory for his mercy." But we will glorify God one way or the other. That is not an issue. It is not a problem. There is nothing to be solved anymore. There's no controversy. Why is this, and to whom is this a controversy then? This is God's problem now. We can't solve this problem. But because of God's love, because he loves us, because he has mercy upon us, he adopted this issue into his problem. And what is the cosmic question that he is now asking, that the problem that he now has to solve is this: how can God interact with sinners without compromising both his mercy and his justice? If he just says, "You're okay as you are, just do whatever you want," he compromises his nature, his perfection and his holiness. And if he says, "No, you will go to hell," he compromises his love for us. How will he overcome this problem, this paradox? Let's look at Proverbs 17:15. God's word itself shows us how much of this paradox is. It says, "He who justifies the wicked and he who condemns the righteous, both are an abomination to God." God hates when sinners are unjust, unjustifiable sinners are justified and the righteous are condemned. What will God do with us? Will he just justify us? Or will he send us to hell? Today is God's answer. May this answer feed your soul today. Amen. You are looking for no more comprehensive answer than today's text. Verse 21. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. Today's verse starts with the most glorious two words ever. But now. Amen? But now. There's a difference. There's a change. There's a new paradigm for those perishing under the law. God says, but now I will deal with you in a different way. Now what? A new covenant, a new promise. This covenant will be fulfilled by the blood of Jesus himself, and no longer the blood of lambs, or no longer the blood of guilty sinners who need to die by God's wrath. It is the Lamb of God who would give us a new heart that not just knows the law and therefore falls under a guilty conscience, but knows the law and loves to do it. Ezekiel and Jeremiah cry out that we will have a new heart that finally not just knows what is right, but loves what is right. It solves the ancient human problem. What is the human problem? We know what's right, but we don't love it. We know what's right, but we love the wrong. And God says, I will now unify your heart and your mind with a new covenant. You will love what you profess to be true and good. And my heart is still waiting for that divorce to be reconciled. My mind and my heart, that ancient distance between it, God promises to reconcile by the new covenant. This new heart was given to us when Jesus died upon the cross and sent the Holy Spirit into our hearts. Where could a new and living and a beating heart come from when all of our hearts are dead and twisted and are in evil and sin? Only if you think of the cross as a heart surgery table, and we are lying there as recipients of God's donated heart to us. That is a new covenant. Now, saying that there's a new covenant and a new testament, a new story, doesn't mean that God suddenly changed his mind and said, this is no longer my requirements anymore. Here's a new requirement. That is not doing so. It says here, the law and the prophets bear witness. The old genres of the initial books of the scripture in the Old Testament still bear witness that this would be the case, that a new covenant would come by grace. So there's continuity. There is no divorce. The New and the Old Testament seeing of the same Savior, amen? Amen. And so the new covenant doesn't just pop out of nowhere. It is a continuous and pre-planned active grace of God that set into motion the moment that he promised us the seed of the woman would crush the head of the snake when talking to Eve. God planned it from the beginning that there would be grace for sinners like us. Verse 22. The law and the prophets bear witness to it. What? The righteousness of God, and this is the first time that this is ever said, and it's glorious, through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. This opens the door of Christianity to everyone out there. To the sinner, to the lost, to the prodigal son, to the proud, to the wicked, to everyone, through faith in Jesus. Everything about our salvation comes from outside of us. Amen? Every other religion, they would change this verse. The righteousness of God through effort for those who try. Humanism, materialism, I don't care what ism you attach to your worldview, it all says that you must try to achieve paradise. And we have 6,000, 7,000 years of recorded human history that show the case that we have not created paradise yet. Where is the closest that it is? Sweden? Norway? We have not created paradise yet. By effort and ingenuity and technology and by human advancement, we have not been able to dissect and remove sin and evil in our hearts. 1,000 years would pass, and if Christ has not returned yet, we would be killing each other with AI-guided lasers. Sorry, that's such a random statement. Everything about our salvation came from outside of us. Praise God. God gave us the promise of the new covenant, despite our breaking of the old covenants. God sent Jesus, eternal and coexistent with God, the eternal Word of God, into our world temporarily, in the flesh, incarnate, for our sins, when we should have died, to live the life that we could never have lived. Then God, from external to us, sent His Holy Spirit to seal us with this promise. Everything that we need for salvation came from outside of us. Amen. Because I have looked inside. I have psychoanalyzed. I have spiritually meditated. I have gone on fasting trips. I have gone on spiritual journeys. There is nothing inside that gives me hope. And it can only come from the outside. In the triune redemptive act of God that occurred outside of space-time and outside of especially me, God gifted to us righteousness for those who believe. Amen? To whom? Those who believe and place their faith in Jesus Christ. This is the craziest religion in the world. I'm personally angry sometimes when I see proud people that never meet the requirements and hypocrites and abject sinners who will never want God. When I see the gospel going to them and all they do is a split second and they say, I believe, Lord, forgive me, and they're forgiven, the legalist in me cannot bear the sight of that. You know how hard I tried? You know how much effort went into trying to become a little better me? But that is the faith that we believe in. That even in the last second of our deathbeds, that if we cry out, Lord, forgive me a sinner, give me a new heart, God gives it to you. That is our hope. That is our redemption. The most important and precious thing, salvation and redemption, is given to you as a free gift that no one would boast. Not after you've earned it, not after you've merited it, not after you felt sorry enough or tried every other method. It is given to you when you are blind and naked and you haven't tried everything. You weren't the one step wiser. God gave it to you in Christ, if you just believe. That's why so many middle school students who have no idea about the range of sins that they will commit in the future, that's why so many middle school students are saved in their ignorance, because they cried out one day, Lord, save me, and God saved them from all their future sins that they will commit. Everything that you wrote down in your journals 20 years from your middle school, God forgave you preemptively from that. Amen? All our past, present, and future sins, God forgave. Sinners and wretches, the spiritually bankrupt, hear this story and they celebrate and run to Christ because they know there's no other hope. Do you know who doesn't celebrate this? Decent people. People of Fairfax and Nova, who feel like if they try a little bit more, they're going to get there.
just one more software app that helps them with their meditation, and they'll get to a certain state. Christianity is a backslap to those who say, I'm almost there, I'm almost there. Just one more habit of life. If I read Jordan Peterson's book and I make my bed, I will get there. The decent run away from Christ. The wretched eat and devour and drink of Christ every day. Who are you? Are you almost there? Or do you have no hope? Christ is a Christ for the hopeless. They dare not believe, those decent people dare not believe that the only thing they contributed to their salvation was a sin that necessitated it. The gospel is offensive to the morally awake, especially because you can't enjoy the relativistic sense of superiority or virtue that you have in comparison to another distinction that God points to and says, I don't see a distinction. You're a hypocrite or you're suppressing the truth. The gospel ends virtue signaling amongst Christians. You know, people who fast, they can never keep it to themselves. You know, people that are humble have to talk about their humility. You know, people that tithe want it to be recorded at the church. We virtue signal even now because you don't know the perfect gift of Jesus Christ for you when you totally did not deserve it. May the abject grace of God's goodness crush comparison. Amen. I am a sinner, worse than all of you, a chief, an Olympic representative of my locale. I represent sinners where I am because I am the most informed sinner. I know exactly how I sin. Gospel ends all virtue signaling. Why? Verse 23, for there is no distinction. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Hamartia, what is that? An Olympic term to miss the mark. That's where we get our word sin from, to miss the perfect mark. Whether you throw your arrow backwards and say, I don't care, or whether you aim your best and you hit 0.1 millimeters away from the perfect mark, if you do not achieve full godlike perfection, we have failed our mission. And there's no distinction. To God, all humanity has fallen short. I'll give you an example, maybe a heartwarming example from my home, but nonetheless serious. My daughter, my first daughter, Ilya, is very kind-hearted and very sensitive. She knows the rules and she tries to keep them, and she feels very guilty and horrible when she fails. Ethan, my son, sometimes just doesn't know any better. He's really strong, and just because he's too strong for his own good, he plays around and suddenly his younger sister, Ariel, is sprawled to the ground crying. He just didn't know. He doesn't know what the perfect standards are, but he still does wrong. Ariel, a true miracle and an enigma for our family. I tell her, don't draw on the table, draw on the paper. She looks into my eyes, she makes eye contact, and she draws on the table saying, but I'm not doing anything. She knows, and she does it. All three of them, no distinction. No matter how kind, no matter how ignorant, no matter how blatant, They all draw on the desk. All humans are alike in one aspect. Not how beautiful we are, not how valuable we are, not our Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It's our common inheritance of sin. Whether we know the law and try to keep it and fail, whether we don't know the law and fail to keep it, or know the law and brazenly ignore it and also fail to keep it, the only solution that we have must be a new standard and a new distinction, powerful enough to break the previous distinctions. Amen? What is that new distinction? In Christ or not in Christ, the only way that God has chosen to see a humanity of sinners is now not by behavior and action and consistency with the heart and moral behavior, but whether you are in Christ or outside of Christ. Just like Exodus, the blood of the Passover lamb was covering the doorposts. It didn't matter who you were, whether you owned slaves, even as an Israelite, or how bad-tempered you were. If you hid inside the door that's covered by blood, you were saved and God passed over. So it is for us. If you are inside the territory of Christ by faith, God shows you mercy. Complete, unconditional mercy. I'm helping you fight with assurance of salvation right now. A lot of you still doubt whether you're okay before God. And I say to you, it's not whether you have done enough, it's where you are, in Christ or outside of Him. If you believe you are in Christ, amen? Let's be done with that issue now. Your performance does not impact your salvation. It only demonstrates it, at best, inconsistently. Verse 24 and 25. All have sinned, but are justified by His grace as a gift. A gift. No terms and strings attached through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood to be received by faith. And this verb, this verse stumbles people. There's words like justification, grace, redemption, propitiation. Ah, that's where we get all our Christianese from, right? Here it is. Okay, let me just announce it to you. Crazy news, the new status being in Christ or outside of Christ that we have struggled forever to accomplish with our efforts and have failed forever is given as a gift. How? The solution, how do you get righteousness? How do you get Christ alone? Let's remember a few things. God's nature is a source of the law. That's why God can't just ignore the law, because He can't deny His own nature, right? And you can't just snap away the requirements of the law. It still is binding. You have to then fulfill the law, but not through humanity. Here we see some of the biggest words in Christianity, and this is how God fulfilled it. Hundreds and thousands of books upon books, all thick enough to stand by itself, were written about every single word here. Justification, redemption, propitiation, and faith. Let's define these. What is justification? I'm not going to use the Westminster Standards, but I'm going to just give a short form. God's pardon of your sins and legal declaration that you are righteous. Amen? Legally. That's why a lot of you are still sinners in practice, but God declares over you, you are legal. It's like saying this. It's like an orphan being adopted into a household, and the paperwork is done, right? And the courts declare, he is now your son, but he has 5 to 10 to 15 years of orphan-like living embedded in him. And so his behavior doesn't behave like a child of the family. Like when he looks at food on the table, he still puts it in his pocket because he doesn't know where he's going to get the next meal. And like that, we are declared children of God, but we still behave like sinners who think we have to act and perform to satisfy someone. And so here it is. You are legally declared righteous. That is enough for salvation. Hallelujah. Truly, we couldn't behave enough for sanctification, and we couldn't behave enough to be justified before God ever. So the word justification is the sweetest music to my ears, although there's legal ramifications everywhere about this. What about the word redemption? Redemption is God's deliverance from you and your sin and its consequences. What is propitiation? A difficult word here. It is the satisfaction of God's wrath, because God's wrath against sin must be satisfied or else he is not just. God must judge sin, but in his love for us, he made Jesus, who knew no sin, to become sin, so that when he died upon the cross, he was punished in substitution of our sin. That is called propitiation, or satisfaction of God's wrath. It turns wrath away from you. Do you get that? It turns God's wrath away from you. Jesus is holding back God's wrath with one hand, and he's inviting humanity with his other hand. That's why his hands are spread. He's holding back God's wrath. He's inviting those into a relationship through faith. Finally, what is faith? Remember, notitia, assensus, fiducia, difficult Latin words that talk about the actual event itself, intellectual knowledge and agreement, but actual leaning and fiducia, trust that it is so. What does that mean? Christ actually had to die for you on the cross. That's why the cross happened in a physical world where there's physical historical records that scholars have still not been able to overturn. The best documented piece of history ever in the world is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So it happened. But it now needs your mental agreement. Yes, I agree it happened. But Satan also agrees it happened. What also needs to happen? I now lean upon it, and my life is now different because of how I actually internalize Jesus' salvation. That's notitia, assensus, and fiducia, saving faith. I'm going to try to summarize this. How does this all, these four thick, heavy words, work together? Let's look at the slide. This is also not like a standard definition in a confession, but this is the best sense of the passage that we have according to the Bible, according to the text we're reading right now. It is a binding declaration by God that I have been redeemed from sin and its effects by the merit of Christ's obedience and the propitiation of Christ's blood and death on the cross. So what this means is what I had to do, Christ did for me. The punishment I had to receive, Christ absorbed for me. I get the best of both worlds, and God counts it to me as righteousness on the cross. And how is it applied to me personally? By faith. I believe it happened for me. Amen. No one after this sermon should say, I am too confused to be saved now. What you believe in is that Jesus died for your sins. That is it. Someone should be getting saved today, because there are many unsaved people sitting amongst us right now. Even though you think you're saved, you must know the foundation for your salvation. And this is why faith is so powerful. This sounds complicated, right? That's why I said this was God's problem. We could have never solved this. This is why faith is so powerful. It makes yours what you couldn't accomplish in a billion years. Amen. The perfected work of Jesus, perfect righteousness, behavior, thought, mental attitudes, and expressions, all accomplished, gift-wrapped, extended for you. All you have to say is, I believe and accept. Wow. What other religion does that for you? Verse 25 and 26. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just, like he might be righteous and holy and just, but also be the justifier of those who have faith in Christ. Beautiful. Beautiful. That he would preserve his justice, but also justify and have mercy on those who can't. And the purpose was not to show our righteousness, which is like filthy rags. But the purpose of God's salvation is what? To show his perfection, his kindness, his glory, and his justice, and his patience. What is our greatest hope today? Think of it this way. Repeat after me. The reason for my salvation is not in me. Amen. It's in him. His name, his character, his unchanging attributes, because of who he is forever, that's why he saves you. Therefore, your salvation cannot be shaken. It doesn't depend on you and how you spend tomorrow, what sins you'll commit tonight, what passive-aggressive thoughts you'll have tonight, what gossip and slander you have tomorrow. That doesn't alter your salvation because it comes from God's nature, which is unchanging and infinite. Praise God. It's like having a vault in heaven. Praise God. Your security is secure in a vault that you have no access to right now. I can't corrupt it. I can't touch it. My behavior cannot taint it. That is my hope right now because you know what? To be honest, I should not be up here. Do you know what I do when I sing and worship? I hide behind the shield of faith and I cover my heart with the breastplate of righteousness because every time Satan says, you know what? You know how evil you are? You know how unworthy you are? I say, but Christ alone. Christ alone. Christ is the only reason I could stand up here and be a madman for you is because I am practicing what is taught here. I did not merit my salvation. It is in God. It is safe in God. It is safe as a treasure in Christ. Thank you, God, that my salvation is not shaken. The motivation for God to save you is not in you. Salvation is stable precisely because I cannot impact it. So how did God solve this cosmic question? How can God save sinful humanity without compromising his perfect nature, namely his justice and his love? The cross of Jesus, where mercy and justice meet. Only on that cross can God's wrath be satisfied for justice. And those who believe in the blood of Christ for love can be saved. The issue of Proverbs can be saved. He who justifies the wicked and he who condemns the righteous can only survive because of the cross. Therefore, KCPC, I'm going to show you a video clip. But a lot of you try to find the reason of salvation in yourself. Don't do that anymore. Amen? Simple, clean-cut logic. Don't do that anymore because you don't have to. Your emotions do not define your well-being before God. I ask so many of you, how are you with God today? And you say, I look internally and I feel bad. I did bad. I never QT'd. I never prioritized God. God probably is not interested in me right now. No. God loves you because of his nature. It is secure. Doesn't depend on you. Amen? Let us settle that issue now. Have gutsy guilt when you sin because God still loves you. Don't look to yourself. If your reason for salvation starts with, because I did something and it's the first person, you don't know the gospel, my friend. The only way to say that you're saved is to start with, because he did something that is untouchable and unperishable. Alistair Begg said in a better way, so we're going to watch his video. Let's watch it. from 18 seconds to 227.
So that to go to the old Fort Lauderdale question, if you were to die tonight and you were getting entry into heaven, what would you say? If you answer that, and if I answer it in the first person, we've immediately gone wrong. Because I believed, because I have faith, because I am this, because I am continuing. Loved ones, the only proper answer is in the third person, because he, amen. Because he. And think about the thief on the cross. And what an immense, I can't wait to find that fellow one day to ask him, how did that shake out for you? Because you were cussing the guy out with your friend. You'd never been in a Bible study. You never got baptized. You didn't know a thing about church membership. And yet you made it. You made it. How did you make it? That's what the angel must have said. You know, like, what are you doing here? Well, I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? Well, because I don't know. Well, you know, excuse me, let me get my supervisor. They go get the supervisor in. So, we're just a few questions for you. First of all, are you clear on the doctrine of justification by faith? The guy said, I never heard of it in my life. And what about, let's just go to the doctrine of Scripture immediately. This guy's just staring. And eventually in frustration, he says, on what basis are you here? And he said, the man on the middle cross said, I can come.
Amen.
Now, that is the only answer. That is the only answer. So that to go to the
okay, we'll
old...
stop here. Amen. Did Jesus invite you because he perfected it and gave it to you as a gift? Amen. Oh, the crushing weight of the arrogance that comes with thinking I fulfilled the law. And the crushing guilt that comes from failure of the law. Wiped away by the invitation of one perfect God-man who says, you can come. What do we do with this? This is where I spent my whole week. I'm trying to ask myself, what do we do with this beautiful knowledge? My kids answered it for me. It took us 3 years to visit the tidal basin because every time we went during the cherry blossoms, no parking. And so we went a little before. And as we were walking, all of my kids, you know, the good, the bad, the ugly. We were walking around the tidal basin, and, you know, there was a gay couple getting married. There was probably an FBI agent, no shirt on, just like perfect abs. Probably so self-disciplined. Probably so aware of his requirements of the law, jogging around, and everyone's like, wow, look at his body. Just a tidal basin of human sin. And you know what my children do? I was so surprised and so proud of them. All three of them, the good, the bad, and the ugly, they sang together. And because they couldn't pronounce R, they said, this is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. It sounds nice if you hear it once. They sang it about 70 times, I think. Everyone was staring at us. My children, in my meditation, because I was desperate for a word from God, my children seemed like representatives of humanity. Those who know, but they're so sorry. Those who don't know, and they always ignorantly do sin. And those who know, but don't care, all of them saying, this is my story. This is my song. My Savior did it all for me. all of our stories are replaced by Christ's perfect story. And so we can dance and sing and walk through the stages of life. Why? How? Singing. This is my story. This is my song. My Savior, my Savior, my Savior. They didn't talk about my knowledge, my impact, my effort. My Savior is my story and my song. KCPC, this changes everything. Who do you sing about? Who do you obsess about? Who do you psychoanalyze? Who do you follow? It must be my Savior who solved God's problem for us. Amen. God receive all glory. Thank you for keeping our salvation outside of our hands' reach. Thank you for inviting us after preparing it perfectly. Praise team, come up and we'll respond by worship. As we stand, let me just pray a quick prayer for us. Father, thank you for inviting us. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for not looking to me when determining whether you were going to save me, but thank you for looking at your Son to determine if you were going to save me. And in Christ, it was a yes and an amen by sheer grace. Thank you for the gift. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you that your wrath was averted from me. I am a sinner saved by that grace, and I have no excuse, and I have no boast, but my Savior, who is my song and my story. I will sing of you, Father. I will sing of your Son forever and ever. There's no way to escape this. I will sing of Christ who saved me all the days of my life. May that be KCPC's story. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's respond and worship.
Fortune.
blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
May the God who gave you a blessed assurance, may Christ who became yours forevermore, and may the seal of the Holy Spirit who locks up your salvation and keeps it out of your reach be with you and your children and all who need forgiveness. May it be upon them for their eternal hope and joy forevermore. And God's people said, amen. Let's give all glory to God for what He has done. We are now dismissed. Enjoy the blessed assurance you have, and please deck up your chairs.